This video covers two topics, energy diagrams and Le Chatelier's principle. Here's a theoretical reaction. A plus B goes to C plus D. And we can represent that reaction by using an energy diagram where the vertical axis is energy increasing in the vertical direction. On the horizontal axis, we have the reaction progress. So in other words, A plus B, the starting materials here on the left, C plus D as we move to the right. And the curve represents all the intermediates that might be involved as A and B collide to form C plus D. And this is sort of a typical curve that we might have. As A and B slide over to C and D, we know that we see that there's a hurdle here. And that hurdle is an energy barrier. It's called the energy of activation. When A and B collide, if they don't have sufficient energy, they'll simply coast back to the starting materials and nothing has happened. But every now and then, an A and B collision has sufficient energy that the particles make it over the top of the energy barrier and form the products C plus D. This particular diagram represents an exothermic reaction. That is to say, energy is given off. And we see that because the products, C and D, don't contain as much energy as the starting materials. That means that energy was given off. An energy diagram like this helps us explain how a catalyst works also. A catalyst lowers the energy of activation. It reduces the height of this energy barrier, makes it a little easier for A and B to form product, milder conditions are involved. And so catalysts are tremendously valuable substances because they help reactions to proceed smoothly. Another diagram represents an endothermic reaction. Here again, energy is increasing in the vertical direction. The progress of the reaction down here in the horizontal direction. And we notice that the energy level of the products is greater than that of the starting materials. It means energy was absorbed. It's an endothermic reaction. And you might guess, or it seems reasonable at least, when we look at these energy diagrams, that not only can A and B go over to C and D, but might it not be possible also for C and D collisions to come back and form A and B? In other words, the reverse of the reaction. And in theory, all reactions are reversible. In practice, not all are, but many, many reactions are reversible. Let's look at the reaction of hydrogen and iodine as an example of a reversible reaction. Gaseous hydrogen and gaseous iodine can react to form hydrogen iodide. And at first, as we mix these two gases, there isn't any hydrogen iodide, but after a little while, the concentration of HI starts to build up, and there are also collisions between HI molecules. So it's possible that HI collisions could result in the formation of starting materials. In other words, the reaction can go either direction. Well, what do we really have? Well, it depends upon the experimental conditions. How much hydrogen, how much iodine, and how much HI are actually in this mixture. When a reaction is reversible, we can use two-way arrows like this to indicate that fact. If we set up this reaction and let a period of time go by, initially the concentration of HI is building up, then there are greater and greater collisions of HI to form starting materials. But if we let sufficient time pass, the reaction reaches a state of equilibrium. That is to say, there are no net changes in concentration of starting materials or product. Lots of things are still happening. There are still collisions between hydrogen and iodine and collisions between HI molecules. It's just that there are no net changes in concentration, and we call that equilibrium. It's a little bit like a swimmer swimming in a river. Let's look at that. Here's a stream that's flowing in this direction, and we have a swimmer swimming in the opposite direction. And if the swimmer's rate of swimming matches that of the stream flow, and he marks his position over here by a tree on the shore, the swimmer isn't going to change positions with time. In other words, the swimmer is at equilibrium. Lots of things are happening. Stream is flowing, the swimmer is swimming. It's a state of dynamic equilibrium. Le Chatelier applied the Le Chatelier principle to systems at equilibrium. And Le Chatelier said that when a stress or a change is applied to a system at equilibrium, the system responds to minimize the change. Sounds a little bit like Congress, doesn't it? For example, you're at a position of equilibrium. Muscular forces are keeping you vertical. Gravity is tending to pull you down, but you're in the state of dynamic equilibrium. Now, what if someone were to come up and gently push you back? Well, to prevent yourself from falling, you'll do what? You'll lean in the opposite direction. You'll try to minimize that push so that you don't fall over. Or another example, if you're going around a corner in a car, here you are in the vertical direction, and as you go around the corner, centrifugal force throws you out. What do? You try to minimize that change by leaning in the opposite direction. And that's what Le Chatelier's principle says, that when we apply a stress or a change to these reactions at equilibrium, the reaction is going to respond by trying to minimize the change. Let's look at some reactions. Here's our theoretical reaction. A plus B goes to C plus D, and it's a reversible reaction. So it can go either direction, in other words. And we've let sufficient time go by. It's reached a state of equilibrium. And now let's apply a stress. Let's add some more A and see what happens. Well, additional A, the reaction is going to respond by trying to minimize that additional A. How can it do that? Well, it can do that by shifting the equilibrium to the right. In other words, using up some A and forming more C and D. Let's see what happens if we do the opposite. Let's remove some A. Well, that's not quite as easy to rationalize, but if adding A shifts to the right, then removing A certainly would shift the equilibrium to the left. And I think, let's go back to adding A. I think you can envision how that might happen. If it's necessary for A and B to collide to form products, and we add more A, well, there are going to be more collisions between A and B. And so we'll get more product. Let's look at C. Let's add C. Well, if collisions between C and D can give rise to A and B, and we add more C, it's going to shift to the left. If I remove C, just the opposite, it shifts to the right. It's always easier for me, when you face questions like that, to envision what happens if I add, and then if the question pertains to what happens if you remove, well, it's going to be the opposite. Let's look at a real-life equation. Here's a very important reaction, has many benefits for society, represents the reaction of gaseous nitrogen and hydrogen to form ammonia, an important fertilizer. And as I've indicated, it's an exothermic reaction. Heat is given off. Let's assume now that we've set this reaction up. Sufficient time has passed. It's reached equilibrium. Let's add H2. Well, if I add one of these starting materials, there's going to be more collisions. The position, the state of equilibrium is going to shift to the right. We'll get more product. Another question that might be asked, all sorts of questions are possible. We could add this, add this, add ammonia, add heat, or we could remove any of those. Let's look at what happens if I remove NH3. If I add NH3, it's going to shift to the left. So if we remove it, it's going to shift to the right. Let's look at heat. And treat heat just like A or B. We could even give a letter H to heat if you like. If I add heat to this process, it's going to shift to the left. If I cool, just the opposite, it'll shift to the right. If we had a chemical manufacturing plant, here's a process that we're interested in accomplishing. And one of the materials is very expensive. Let's say B is very expensive and A is pretty cheap. We'd like to get as much product as we can over here. Well, I'm going to use the minimum amount of B. We need some B in order to get product, but I'm going to use whatever we've got there, and then I'm going to dump in a ton of A. According to Le Chatelier's principle, that's going to push the reaction to the right, and we'll get maximum amounts of C and D. We could use heat in the same way. If we heat this process, it'll push the reaction to the right. And over here with the products, if we have a way of removing C and D, that'll help pull the reaction to the right. Chemical manufacturers use all of these tools based upon Le Chatelier's principle to maximize the products that they're after.